and Minister Patricia Venus Henry. Join me every Sunday right here on the Tobago Inspirational Network at 9:30 p.m. for Stepping on the High Waters. Stay tuned because God is turning things around for us in this season. Good evening, viewers. Welcome to Stepping on the High Waters. It's good to be in your homes once again, and I believe that this evening the Lord has something wonderful in store for each and every one of us. So as usual, sit back, relax, and allow the Spirit of the Lord in your hearts and in your homes. And this evening with me, I have no other than Pastor Rex Henry from the Wesleyan Holiness Church in Lowlands. Good evening, Pastor. How
good
are
evening.
You?
I'm good.
Okay. I just want to go straight into this topic. Mm-hmm. Who the cap fit, let them wear it.
Okay.
And, you know, what day it was, I was calling up some people for, you know, we have the D-Day prayer day coming up on the 20th of June okay. of this month here at 4 o'clock at the Esplanade.
Okay.
And, you know, looking at the declarations and stuff like that, I'm saying, God, you know, this thing is a serious thing where you need your men and women of God to declare over the nation and declare over the people of the nation, declare God's mind mm-hmm. for the people. And I was looking at Exodus 33 with Moses, where God and Moses had a meeting, mm-hmm. a serious, serious encounter, where God was telling Moses to take the people from where they were up to another place. Mm-hmm. And he was explaining to Moses that, listen, these people that I told you to carry up to this place with milk and honey, mm-hmm. and these people, stiff neck, you know, just picking out the path, they were stiff neck. Mm-hmm. And as he said in verse 2, said, I will send an angel mm-hmm. With you, mm-hmm. and he will drive out the Hittites, the Perizzites, the Jebusites, all the sites onto mm-hmm. a land flowing with milk and honey.
Okay.
And you know, he said that he would not go with them because they are stiff neck people, lest he consume them. Mm-hmm. And I kept going on and on where when they heard the indictment against them, they began removing all the ornaments off of them and stuff like that. And people began to mourn and groan and stuff like that because they realized that the Lord was serious, mm-hmm. you know. And I like verse 7. Mm-hmm. Which says, and Moses took the tabernacle and pitched it without the camp, afar off from the camp, and called it the tabernacle of the congregation. And it came to pass that everyone which sought the Lord went out unto the tabernacle of the congregation, which was without a camp. Mm-hmm. And it came to pass when Moses went out unto the tabernacle, that all the people rose up and stood every man at his tent door and looked after Moses mm-hmm. until he was gone. Okay? And 9 said, and it came to pass as Moses entered into the tabernacle, the cloudy pillar descended and stood at the door of the tabernacle, mm-hmm. and the Lord talked with Moses. And all the people saw the cloudy pillar stand at the tabernacle door, and all the people rose up and worshiped every man in his tent. Talk to me. Who the cap fit? And talk to the viewers. Who the cap fit? Let them wear it.
Well, and this is an emphasis on leadership. Uh-huh. It's an emphasis on how God leads our people. Mm-hmm. And God leads our people through a shepherd, mm-hmm. through a person. Maybe we could contrast the glory of this event with what is considered one of the lower events of Moses' experiences.
Yes.
There was a time that came when Moses was I don't know if he was having marriage problems. But his big sister and brother came up and they said to him, anybody could lead. God has called us as well as you, you know. And Moses, being a meek person, meaning that he backed out of this argument. And they found themselves confronting God on their own without Moses. When God is selecting a leader, God is thinking about the nature of the heart of the man or woman. And God is trying to express himself through the attitudes of that person. Now, sometimes we come to God with assumptions about who he is. God says that his ways are above our ways, like the heaven is above the earth. And therefore, the things that are important to God may not be important to us. And the things that are important to us may not be important to God. So mm-hmm. God has to pick a leader who has the ability to understand the nature of God. And then this thing that God is doing is putting a separation between the leader he has chosen and the rest of the people.
Okay.
So that so God is almost in a way lending his glory to the man.
Okay.
So that it is clear that this is the man on whom the cap is fitting.
Okay.
Right. The second part of our topic, which is let them wear it, has to do with the fact that sometimes God can call a person who does not respond to the calling.
Yeah.
They don't say yes. They don't leave where they're at and follow after God and that kind of thing. Typical example is when Elijah threw his mantle on Elisha. Mm-hmm. And Elisha knew that he was called. Okay. And he told him, give me a minute, let me go back and tell my parents that I'm called into the ministry and I'm going to burn my yoke and I'm going to kill the animals and I'm going to have a feast and then I will follow you. There is a distinctive line that draws the line between the holy and Ezekiel says and the profane.
Okay.
It's what separates what God has sanctified from that which God has not sanctified.
Yeah.
So that holiness really in its essence means to be different. And so God has a tendency to separate the leader from the people. Now, the topic raises the issue, a deeper issue, which is, is God going to go with your nation when it travels through its journey? Is God with your nation? And these people had an attitude that they wanted whatever they wanted, whenever they wanted it.
Doing their own thing.
Yeah. And sometimes people are not holy. They're in a holy nation, yes, but they're not holy. It's like people going to church, but they're not really committed to this Christian thing. One person called it fire insurance.
Okay.
Right? People get saved, they get fire insurance. They go up to the altar, they cry, they weep and thing, and they accept Christ and they get baptized because what they're really getting is fire insurance. There is a suspicion in the back of their mind that hell is real and that someday they're going to die and go to hell. And so they take enough Christianity, just enough, to ensure that if Jesus comes back in their lifetime, they are not going to hell.
Okay.
But they're not committed to the kingdom. They're not committed to his government. They're not committed to his laws. They don't pay tithes. They don't attend
it's
services.
A culture thing.
Yeah,
kingdom versus culture.
Right, they don't.
Okay.
And sometimes it's kingdom versus faithlessness.
Okay.
And I think the children of Israel were dealing with that problem right through, because when they first was called to go up against Ai, they bucked and backed down, saying God brought us to kill us. But then it's an option either going forward or going back into the desert. So they decide to go up and fight.
Okay.
And they lost the fight. The thing is that the New Testament says that those that the church that was in the wilderness did not mix it with faith. What they heard, they did not mix it with faith.
Okay.
And so the problem is that you cannot really be led by a leader who you do not believe in. You can't really be led by a leader who you don't believe that God has called them and given that person to you as a leader.
Mm-hmm.
And in this case, in Moses' experience,
it's a confidence problem.
Right. But it goes
like a trust problem.
Yeah, it's a confidence in the person, but it's also a lack of confidence in God.
Yeah.
Because sometimes you can be sure that God gave you, like when the brother and sister had a issue with Moses. The issue is, yes, we know God's called him, but God has called us too. So in that case, the evidence, the lack of confidence is in the man.
Okay.
The rest of the nation had a lack of confidence in God and in God's ability to make choices for leadership. And so sometimes the cloud coming down, it's not that God can't meet him without a cloud and a fire. But I have to use the fire and the cloud in order to reinforce the idea that this man is speaking for me. And sometimes when things are happening in the lives of a leader, people are looking for blood. So they most of the time, idolatry is the idea that we want his job. Mm. We want his money. We want his house. We want the things that he has.
And you're making it look obvious.
Yeah, we want those things. And if I want the things you have, I have to find a way to wait until blood is oozing from you.
Okay.
And when blood is oozing, there's some weakness that is obvious. We make that weakness bigger than it needs to be so that we can cause other people to demote you or denounce you so that we can have that space. And okay. And it's a form of idolatry because it's a kind of witchcraft, because you're manipulating people into making you their choice.
Okay.
Rather than trusting God to speak to them about supporting you as
well, that solution. Usually backfires.
Yeah, yes it does. Yeah, eventually,
in
yeah.
a big way, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Because we shouldn't aspire to things that we don't have the grace to carry.
True.
You know,
true.
I wouldn't want to be Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago. I wouldn't want to be President of Trinidad and Tobago. People would say, well, you know, it's a prestige position and it has this and it has that, but consider the possibility that there are responsibilities. Mm-hmm. A Chief Secretary or a Prime Minister of Trinidad and Tobago has, every time somebody has a function, they invite you to come.
Yep.
Right? And if you don't come, they think that you're disrespecting them. But they're not aware that 10 people invited you this week.
Mm-hmm.
Right? And in these 10 events that invited you, you were meant to go. But you have a wife, you have children, you may have school that you're managing, you have personal issues, you may be tired, sometimes you get sick, and you need some rest, you need some time. But if you don't show up, because there'll be people in this country who go to church on Sunday and they want their events on a Saturday night. There are people who go to church on Saturday and they want their events on a Sunday night.
So you need to know the roles and function of the cap.
Right.
Of the one who's wearing the cap.
Yeah. And whether or not you're prepared to wear it.
That is it.
Because once you make the commitment to wear it, there is no... I'm told that even people who sit in office for 4 years in the Tobago House of Assembly, they get no holidays.
Okay.
There's no official holiday time. You can't request a month off from office. So it says that you have to prepare for 4 years of non-stop, on-the-go service to people. And if you do it for 12 years in a stretch or whatever, repeatedly, you have committed yourself to an ongoing process of service without Sabbath, which means times of coming aside and rest from that kind of thing.
Mm-hmm.
So that, but let's, we could spiritualize that too.
Yeah.
The intercessor, and many of our people in our audiences are intercessors, with D-Day coming up. The intercessors on the island of Tobago have to also consider if God has called them to come out to pray, to stand on the high places, to be watchmen that are guardians of the city.
Yeah, stand on the edges
Because sometimes our faith betrays, sometimes we compartmentalize in the sense that we are praying for godly leadership, but sometimes we could be part of a political machinery where you know that the people that you're supporting are ungodly.
Mm-hmm.
And when I say ungodly, I'm not necessarily mean that they're unsaved.
Mm-hmm.
I mean that they're practicing things that are intolerant. It's intolerable to the society. It's unacceptable.
Okay.
Right?
Okay.
And I am saying that the intercessor, the people who are intercessors who are part of political machineries in this country, in Trinidad, in Caribbean, in the wider world, and you'll hear them passionately supporting a person that they know do not have integrity or character or thing. And the intercessor has a cap too. And they should be wearing their cap.
That's right.
As the intercessor who is carrying the heart of God, who is supposed to be praying in the heart of God. Yeah. You know, because the Bible says that we know not what we pray for as we ought, but the Spirit intercedes with groanings that cannot be uttered. And he who knows the mind of the Spirit will grant the petition because we ask according to the will of God.
Mm-hmm.
So the question is the intercessor, all of whom we're inviting on the 20th
to
come, going to stand up and add to their faith virtue.
So should we tie in that with Isaiah 61, the Spirit of the Lord God is upon me because he has anointed me to do good tidings, to
preach the gospel, to the poor, to set at liberty them that are bruised, and proclaim the acceptable year of the Lord. Mm-hmm. And because in some ways, if the Spirit of God is saying that, you know, is that if the Spirit of God is upon me, because he hath anointed me. It's coming back to the issue of holiness, of being separated, I mean. And that's what holiness means, to be different. They put a distinction between the holy. And the profane. That's and right. I am saying that some of the political parties on the island of Tobago are selecting their leaders right now. Mm-hmm. But we are voting for leaders, in some cases, in January, on the basis of what is popular for our color schemes, and not on the basis of how we represent God. So there's the issue. If I'm an intercessor, if I'm a pastor, if I'm a social leader, counselor, whatever ministry I have been called to have, if I'm in the healing ministry, the question that must emerge is this. Have I selected a human above the calling of God? On me. Because idolatry says the reason I voted for this person may be because I want a thing. I want him to pave my yard, or I was looking for a better job, or there is something carnal that I want. And I am selling out God for the thing. You know? And I would be guilty of betraying God and his kingdom for a thing. Somebody comes and says, I will give you another house. If you vote for us, we'll give you a house. If you vote for us, we will do this. If you vote for us, we'll betray it. It's cultural, but cultural can be demonic. Cultural can be demonic. And our Christianity now has to penetrate down into the roots of altering culture. Christianity must disciple culture. That's part of the mission of the church. The church has to disciple culture. Jesus said, go into all the world and teach all nations. And the expansion of that word means bring them into your classroom. So if we brought the government into the classroom of the church to teach kingdom, we cannot say, well, look, we're going to teach the classroom the way the world does it. The kingdom... If the kingdom has a classroom, the kingdom's classroom must have a culture.
So should the church now, in essence, must come back to the teaching of kingdom versus culture?
Yes.
Because if we look deeply, we see a lot of culture winding its way into kingdom affairs, into kingdom business. And according to Sister Petunia and Sister Marva, is that just now, it comes like the essence of the kingdom would be wiped out because it seems as though the culture start growing like mistletoe on the church.
Yeah.
So we need to get back to basis.
Well, Jesus raised an issue. You know? Jesus said, when the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith in the earth? It was a very interesting question Jesus was asking. When the Son of Man cometh, shall he find faith in the earth? If the concern that Jesus has is that there might not be faith in the earth, then the risk that we have is that Satan's effectiveness of penetrating the church might be of such... It'll be so good because here's one of the concerns I've had. I believe the Holy Spirit is talking about the purifying of the intent of the church. Very early in the church moved from its Jewish base to its Romanization. Rome was a global institution. And it was a nation that was absorbing all kinds of cultural groups. But it also had a ruler that rose up who was a people said he was crazy, that Nero was mad. Mm-hmm. Nero used to burn Christians on stakes in his persecution of them, while he had very intense debaucheries in the thing. History says he would lock the door. And he would lock the door in order to have his nastiness. Mm-hmm. And in order to light up his garden, he would put Christians on fire in the corners of this room. Okay. Now, Book of Revelation talks about a dragon that was in Egypt. We knew that, and this dragon then went north to Rome. Mm-hmm. What the writer, John the Revelator, is saying by that statement is that that which persecuted the Jews in Egypt, that same spirit, has now gone to Rome and will persecute the Jews that are in Rome. And this is important because Rome is ruling the world. Mm-hmm. Now, if Satan is going into Rome with an intention that he will persecute Jewish thought, it is not surprising that in about 300 years, much of the Jewishness of our church disappeared. And Satan's strategy was to cause the people who call themselves the bishops of the church, the leaders of the church, would be people who were not Jewish.
Okay.
And therefore, a lot of the things that were said would not make sense from a Jewish perspective, until the whole church followed Gentile perspectives.
Okay.
So take, for example, Passover. Jesus was our Passover lamb. To the non-Jewish mind, that means nothing. What we can say to people is that Jesus died at Easter. Mm-hmm. But Easter was a festival for bunnies.
Okay.
Right? Easter is a festival for bunnies. Passover is the time when you sacrifice a lamb because you're remembering that God delivered the children of Israel out of Egypt, mm-hmm. out of the oppression of the devil.
That's right, that's right.
Right? 40 days from Passover is the Feast of Weeks. And what we celebrate as Whit Sunday. Mm-hmm. But it is the time when we are celebrating the birth of the church.
Okay.
Right? Now, by dismantling the relationship between Passover and the Jesus arrived going into heaven, the power of God being poured out into the church, those historical events lose their significance. So you have a lot of people celebrating Easter when it may not coincide with Passover at all.
Okay.
You understand me? Mm-hmm. So that for God to bring back the church, he has to raise up prophets. God is never without options. Okay. So what happens is that when a nation goes into backsliding, when a nation loses its way, God sends in prophets.
Okay. So now we are saying, what are we saying to the people? Is just time to come back on point.
Yes.
Those of us who God gave hat caps to wear, mm-hmm. it's time to put your caps on, mm-hmm. if you took it off.
Yeah.
And those who is already wearing it, mm-hmm. is to. The time has come for us to wear these hats on a stronger note. Mm-hmm. So we have a few minutes left. So let's engage the people into a place where the time has come. The time is now. God is doing a new thing. Mm-hmm. And as he said to Moses, that thing that you asked about, I'm going to give it to you, which is, he will send the Holy Spirit. The presence of the Lord, mm-hmm. will go with them on their journey. And we are on a journey. So we have a few minutes. Talk with the people. And then we will advertise the D-Day once more.
Every believer out there who's hearing our voice needs to hear that the Spirit of God will not live in an unholy place. Mm-hmm. And therefore, even if several weeks ago we talked about the fire of God being poured out into the air,
right.
that revival
yeah.
is close to us.
Right.
Much of revival that has come, as we've said before, comes when repentance is occurring. So we, the believers, have to engage in a process of repentance. Just that would occur soon in a public platform.
Yeah.
So it is the contagiousness of repentance that often leads to the intensity of the holiness of God.
Okay.
And the holiness of God restores the nature of changing the society, what we call revival.
Okay.
So the believer today who is sitting in a place where he's hearing the sound of a voice must repent.
Okay.
The conviction that you're feeling, if you're feeling conviction, it is the presence of God trying to get back your attention, trying to remind you that you are his, you're bought with a price, and that he's concerned about you personally, okay, and that he wants you. If we can get that conviction for us and then begin to help others feel that sense of the holiness of God, then we will feel the burden of the anointing. The anointing is often called a weight.
True, yeah.
It talks about the weight of the anointing coming upon on a person. It is something that makes you, the weight of your mind, makes you heavy in the realm of the spirit. Mm-hmm. If that begins to happen and you begin to do the right thing, now sometimes people want to do big things. Let's not do big things.
Yeah,
let's do little things well.
True, do it perfect.
Right. Yeah. So as we go to this place of repentance in little things, mm-hmm, God is going to allow that to transform our spaces, our homes, by extension our communities, and let's replace our idols, the things that we're going after, for the flesh, for the things that we want, for the things that we know that God's called us to.
Amen. Viewers, we just thank you for viewing with us, and we are just igniting you to get back into that place where God wants us to be. And on this note, we just want to invite you to the Esplanade on the 20th of this month, June, with Apostle Vernon Duncan. He will be in Tobago with D-Day. So come down and we will make declarations over Tobago. We are calling all intercessors who are wearing that cap to come out on the 20th of June with the Esplanade, at the Esplanade, and join us in declaration over Tobago. So you have a blessed week, and allow the presence of the Lord to be filling you up daily. If the cap fit, wear it. Bye for now.